Hello, welcome. Today we are going to discuss about remaining experiments from our subject product design engineering. I hope you remember that we completed our two experiments, and most of you have submitted the assignments that were given for that experiments. Now, in this session, I will cover the remaining experiments theoretically, because since it is a software based subject and experiments are on softwares, so I have converted that software based things in theoretical, and I hope you will do the experiments, do the things that I have proposed in this experiment, and this will help you to learn the concepts very easily. Okay, so to start with, there are some instructions. See, we have Google Classroom, and most of you not submitted the two experiment assignments, the earlier one. Till very few of you have submitted that in the Google Classroom. So I will be sharing the classroom code and the link in the group after some time. Then I expect that you visit there. And you can find there that there are various whatever the lectures that we have conducted till now, it is available there. You can go through that. Also, there are some PowerPoint presentations, some material is there, you can go through that. Some extra material is there also. Now, the remaining experiments are like that. The first one is CNC programming. The second one is CNC programming with examples. So in first case, that is the first experiment, CNC programming, and the second experiment, CNC programming examples, manual part programming rather. So I have prepared some videos for that. That videos are available in the Google Classroom. You have to go through that, and also these presentations are available in the notes section or PPT section. You can go through that, and what you have to do is write down whatever the given in the PowerPoint presentation as an assignment, and you have to submit this in the Google Classroom, not on WhatsApp. Okay, so earlier some of you have submitted the experiments assignments on WhatsApp, but it is not feasible for me to check and give the marks. So I request you to submit these assignments experiments in the Google Classroom. Okay, so for CNC 1 and CNC 2, in CNC 1, what we have, we have the basics of CNC programming, CNC machines. So what are those different types, and what is the advantage, what is the disadvantage, how does the CNC work, what are the different components, how they are classified, everything has been given or shown or taught in that lecture. So you have to go through that. There are three lectures for CNC. In that three lectures, you will get to know how CNC works, right? So CNC 1 and CNC 2 write up, you have to write it from the PowerPoint presentations, and you have to go through the lectures that are provided at the Google Classroom. Okay, now the third experiment, which is user interaction experiment. Already we had gone through user interaction in previous sessions. Before this exam of yours, we were discussing about user interaction, and we have gone through different possibilities or details of user interaction. So I hope you understood that, and you have to write the data or details about user interaction, basics of user interaction, types, etc. That is given in the user interaction lectures. You can go through user interaction lectures, as well as these PowerPoint presentations have been uploaded at the Google Classroom also. So you can go through that and you can download it, and rather you can just go through and write it down. So 3 to 4 pages will be sufficient for that. So this is how we are going to complete our 3 experiments. Earlier we have completed our 2 experiments. Okay, now there are total 8 experiments and 3 are remaining. So now the next experiment is specification, product specification, that we are going to discuss in this lecture. Let me share the screen with you. Just a minute. Okay, first what we will do, we will go with PCB layout experiment. What is PCB and all that. I hope you are able to see this particular slide. I am going to explain this in short span of time, and what you have to do, you have to just go through this lecture again and learn this thing and write it down on the paper. Okay, whatever the questions you will be having, just keep on messaging me. I will reply to that if you have any. Okay, so the experiment or the thing that we are going to discuss today is PCB, how it is used in electronic product development cycle, or how electronic product development cycle can be learned by using a PCB manufacturing. Okay, so whenever you are going to manufacture a product, the first thing is to design a product, right? You already know that. Now in this case of PCB, what is the full meaning of PCB is P for printed, C for circuit, B for board. Now this term or this component you might have seen earlier, but you didn't have gone through it, or you don't understand how this particular thing work. Some of you have good knowledge, like Manjunath and some other people are there. They are having a good knowledge of PCB, okay. But most of you don't know how this PCB works and how to create this PCB. So that we are going to discuss today. So today's agenda for this particular experiment is how we are going to manufacture a PCB. Again, the manufacturing process is also shown in a video that I have already put in the Google Classroom. So you can share that, you can view that, and you will get to know how the PCB manufacturing is already actually done. Okay, so PCB is printed circuit board. You can see these are types of PCBs you have encountered in your day-to-day life. So what is a PCB? It is a mechanical solution to an electrical or electronic problem. Okay, so suppose you have these different kinds of wirings and all these things to join with some other part or a display or something like that. In that case, you if you go without PCB or printed circuit board, what you have to do, you have to use different large number of wires, and every time it gets very complicated if you have to rectify an error or anything like that. Okay, so in that case this part is going to help you. This is called as printed circuit board. So basically it is a board, and on that you can see different components are mounted. Okay, so that is why it is called as mechanical solution to an electrical problem. Now what does printed circuit board do for us? Circuit connects components through board. As we have seen in the earlier slide, these are the components and there are some connections. You can see that these are the connections. Okay, so this is how it is connected, made of alternating layers of conducting and insulating material. So conducting material is the one which conducts the electricity, and insulating material is the one which doesn't conducts but insulates it from the other things. Okay, so what are the basic components of a printed circuit board? You can see that this is a part. You can see both views, top view and bottom view. Okay, then there are drill fields. These are drill files or drill fields, you can call it as. Then there is copper material, copper pads and traces. This is called as pad, and these are called as traces. The lines are called as traces. Okay, and you have to use soldering gun and different other things to just put on the wirings. Okay, from that output and input. Now what are the basic steps in PCB design? So first you have to generate a film. Okay, so you can just create a film in a software, or you can download a ready-made film or ready-made circuit from the internet. You just have to take the print of it. Okay, and you have to take a raw material like a copper material, and you have to paste this particular page on this component, and you can just go with the drillings as shown here. Okay, then apply copper in hole barrels. So after that the image has been applied. This is a bit advanced technique. So basic technique is that you have to just paste the image on the board, and then in some cases what people do, they do the drilling afterwards. In some cases they do the drilling prior to applying, because they know the exact position. Okay, so it is a photosensitive material which is applied over here to develop the selected area of the panel. Now there is etching process is there. So basically etching process can be carried out if you are using a very simple material with the help of water. In some cases some chemicals are being used, and then after etching, the film which was called as the dry film, which is get removed from the surface, and finally you will get a printed board like this. Okay, on that you have to use the solders for soldering purpose on the pads, that the rectangular or square shapes that I have already shown you, they are called as solder boards. And finally you will apply different components and whatever the things are there, that drawings or you can call it as letters, that are put on here. So this is how the final board will be completed, and after that the components are placed accordingly. Okay, so this is how your PCB designing is going to work. So this is very simple and not so complicated thing for you. So I guess you understood this, and just go on to download this presentation and write down how to design PCB or whatever the given in this particular thing. So this completes your experiment number of PCB designing. Okay, now let's move to the next experiment. What you have to do in product specification, what we are going to see. So the concept development process that I have already told you during the product development discussion. Okay, at the time of product development, we have to rely on concept development process. So if you go through this, you can observe that there are two rectangles which are darker one. What does it tells? Establish the target specifications, and second one is set the final specifications. Okay, so while writing this particular thing of product specification, you have to draw this diagram also. Okay, so the two things that we need to stress upon is the establishing the target specification in earlier part of the concept development process, and final part of the setting final specification. So let us move on. What does this mean, and what are going to be we are going to discuss outline of these things. Okay, so let us go to the nature of specification. So what is a specification? The reference point for functionality design and quality planning. So specification manje kay? Specification means it is a reference point for functionality design. How your product is going to function, that design you are going to do, and quality planning, the planning which is needed to obtain the highest quality. Okay, so this is called as specification. It is a reference point. A product assembly usually requires a hierarchy of specification for the final product and each of its component. So you can understand what does this particular statement tells about the specification. A product assembly, whenever there is an assembly of product, it requires, means there are number of components which are being integrated or assembled in a single component. It requires a hierarchy of specification. Hierarchy means the hierarchy could be done with the help of different parameters, like the dimension parameter we can take it as, the weight parameter we can take it as, the importance parameter we can take it as, or the internal component, external component, the smaller component, the bigger component, like that we have to make the hierarchy of specifications. So it requires a hierarchy of specification for the final product and its components. Okay, now the product specification process, how does this work? So first you have to set the target specification. As we have seen in earlier diagram, that setting the target specification at the initial stage of concept development is very important. Okay, so there are number of parameters or features that we are going to see in that. It is based on customer needs and benchmarks. What customer needs and what is a benchmark? Benchmarking, if you know what is meant by benchmark, benchmarking is a set of standards that already been set. Okay, so what in a simple example we can say that if you want to score in an exam, you set some benchmark. Okay, I will score 60%, I will score 70%, I will score 90%. That is the benchmark that has you have gone through. That is called as benchmarking. Okay, so customer needs and benchmarking is the two are the two parameters on which this set of setting of target specification is done. Then we have to develop metrics for each need of customer. There are, it is not like that the customer will have only one need from one product. Okay, so customer will may have different needs for different products, so there could be different needs. So you have to develop the metrics for that particular thing. Then you have to set ideal and acceptable values. Ideal values, the standard one, and what are the acceptable means, where we can give some tolerances. Okay, then you have to refine this specific. This is the setting. First step is setting. The second one is refinement of specification. It is based on selected concept and feasibility testing. Okay, and technical and economical modeling you have to do, and trade-off, and trade-offs are also critical in that case. Okay, the refinement process, just consider it as a refinement process. and then reflect on the results and the process. Critical for ongoing improvement. It should reflect on the results and the process that you are going to adapt. Okay, so these are the three steps for using product specification process. Okay, and these are the things procedure for establishing target specification. Establishment of target specification. There is another procedure. In this, you have to first identify a list of metrics and measurements you need that sufficiently address the needs. So customer need is focused in that. Then the collect the competitive benchmarking information that we have already discussed in the earlier slide. How benchmarking is done. Okay, that you have to collect the competitive benchmark. Set ideal and marginally acceptable target. Already that we have discussed, and then reflect on the results and the processes. That is what we have already seen. Okay. Now final specification. After the in the first stage we are getting the setting the target specification. In final stage we are finalizing the specification. So in that case, develop technical models to assess technical feasibility. So we have to check the technical feasibility of what the work we have done. The input is design variable and the output is a measurement using a metric. So you have to give input as a design variable. If you change the design in this way, if you change the design in that way, what will happen? That you have to calculate or technically assess. Okay, and now the output is a measurement. You will get the output in a measurement term, and it is in a metric. Okay, it is in some quantity or metric units. Okay, develop a cost model of the product. You have to develop the cost model also. Costing is very important, since the industry or company is always going to see whether they are going to make money from this or not. So costing of the model is costing model is also very important. Then refine the specification, making trade-offs where necessary, form a competitive map. This is a bit management type of technique. Don't get involved in it, in that. You just go to the refinement of the specification. You just need to focus on this refinement of the specification. Whatever the specification you have set in earlier stage, and you are getting the target or final specification. So refinement is also important. Then flow down the overall final overall specs to specs for each subsystem. Suppose you are going to make an assembly of a car. So for the particular car, you will have 1,000, 2,000, 5,000 different components in that. Okay, so you have to go through each and every component, its standardization, its specification, customer needs, your availability, your feasibility of your component, and then you have to match up that. So how that is matched up, that we are going to discuss in the next slides. Okay, so you just go, you have to keep this in mind while making the final specifications. You have to go through each and every component. Okay, see, this is an example of a bicycle, mountain bicycle, we can call it as. Okay, so mountain bicycle has this part which is called as suspension fork. Okay, now let us see how they have done the specification or product specification. Okay, so what they have need, they have considered first. The first is the customer needs. What customer need? So there are 20 different parts, different types of needs they have assumed or they have surveyed. So first is reducing the vibration to the hands, allowing easy reversal of slow, difficult terrain. Enables high speed descent on bumpy trails, allows sensitivity adjustment. So these are the different types of needs of the customer. And after the needs, you can observe there is a column which is given the importance. Okay, the points, number of 5 point given in the in that columns are 1 to 5. So 1 means is of least important, and 5 means is of maximum importance. Okay, or you can also go in the different way. 5 means least important, and 1 means very important. Okay, so these are the different categories or types that you can perform or you can go through to assess or analyze the customer needs. So in this step, what we have done, we have analyzed or made the customer needs. Now in second step, you have to establish the metrics and the unit. Again, there are different metrics. You can see that metric number 1 to 26 are given here, and there are needs. Again, the needs are, which needs are interrelated, that are again combined in this particular area. Okay, and the metric has been given here. Again, they have given the importance, and in this step you have to give the units also, in which units you have you are going to observe this metric. Like preload, you have to give the Newton, maximum value for the monster, minimum descent time on test track, okay, s and millimeters and kilonewton per meters, kilograms, total mass. Okay, these are the different types of units that you have to give. And after that, what you have to do, you have to link the metric to the needs. These are the needs, these are the metrics, 1 to 20, 1 to 26. And according to that, you have to map or benchmark or mark on these areas. Okay, is lightweight, is total mass. These are the things which are going to be very crucial while setting the specification, final specification. These are the points that you need to consider very with utmost care. And these are the parts where the boxes which are empty one, these are not that important. Okay, so if you go to use this area only, you will have to give less time, and also you will achieve your target. So this is how linking of metrics to the needs in is done. So this is how the final specification is set up. Okay, so I hope you understood this concept also. Now we have to move to the last experiment, which is software documentation. Okay, let me again share the screen with you. Software documentation. Give me a minute. Okay, I'm not able to maximize this, but let it be. I hope you are able to see this. Okay. Oh yes, it is. So software documentation is the last experiment, or documentation is needed for every purpose that we are going to discuss. Okay, so why it is used, how it is used, what are the different types, what are the different standards that are used in software documentation, that we are going to discuss in. Okay. So why the reasons for software documentation that we are going to discuss, types of software documentation, and ways to implement this software documentation. If you consider the documentation word or the concept of documentation, you will have in your mind that we are going to make some papers or pages like that. Okay, so this is how it is going to work. Okay, so documentation requirements, why documentation is needed. If you read that, you will get to know, in all the software projects, some amount of documentation should be created when prior to any code being written. So these are called as design codes. While having any software being designed or coded, you have to write the documentation. You have to write the codes first. It's not like that you are going to directly code the software. Okay. documentation should continue after the code has been completed. So when the code is completed, the software is completed by in its initial stage and its final stage, and you have to give the user manual, that is called as document, right? The two main types of documentation are created, and that are called as, the first one is process documentation and the second one is product documentation. Okay, process documentation, it is used to record and track the development process, how the product is has been developed, or what are the different things they have considered while developing this product, is can be assessed or can be analyzed by using the process documentation. And this is created to allow for successful management of the software product. Okay, what are the different things we can get in that? In the process documentation, we have planning, we have schedules, we have standards, we have funding, how funds have been created, generated and evolved from this particular process. Okay, so these are the things in process documents. Has a relatively short lifespan. Process document has short lifespan. It is only important to internal development process. So how product is going to be manufactured, that is kept in your industry. You are not going to expose this to your customer. In some cases, if some agency or if some researcher want to assess this, then you have to provide this. Okay, so basically it is for internal development process. Now the product documentation, this describes the delivered product. What was the final product you have delivered to the customer, that is known or analyzed by using the product document. Okay, this must evolve with the development of the software product. So product documents gets evolved with the product development process, that you have to keep in mind. There are two main categories, system documentation and user documentation. Let us see in detail what is system documentation. This system documentation describes how the system works, but not how to operate it. Okay, are you getting the difference? System documentation, how system works is different and how to operate it is different. Okay, so you have to be careful while writing or reading this kind of sentences. System documentation is describes how the system is going to work, but not how to operate it. Okay, then how to operate it is which kind of document will provide this, that we are going to see. Now, user documentation has two main types. See, system documentation and user documentation. In user documentation, you have given the data, which the how to operate the product, that is given in end, that is given to the end user or system administrator. Okay, so that is called as user documentation. In some cases, these are the same people. Okay, the target audience must well be understood. In some cases, you have to give the user documentation and product documentation, both. You have to perform the both operations or both things. Okay. Now, now there are certain things about document quality. Obviously, providing thorough and professional documentation is important for any size of product development team. That means you, the whatever the document you are going to provide, it must be thorough and it should be professionally prepared. Okay, it should not have some spelling mistake, grammatical mistake, paragraph mistake and editorial mistake, in short we can call it as. So it should be professional. The problem is that many software professionals lack the writing skills to create professional level documents. So the problem is that many of the people who are going to develop a product, a software product, they lack the writing skills. So basically you are not going to exactly write with the pen, okay, but while before going to type the document, you must have the written draft. So that is why it is called as writing skill. It is not like that you are going to write on the computer. Okay, no, you are going to type on the computer, but you have the writing skill. You must have the writing skill. That is the point they are focusing on. Okay, so the all documents for a given product should have a similar structure. Structure should be uniform, similar. Some standards are there, like IEEE standards are there that could be utilized. Then you can provide a cover page on all documents, right? Cover page is there. Divide documents into chapters and section, like we make in the seminar report or project report or subsection, right? Add an index if there is a lot of reference information. If you are going to get some references, then you have to add the glossary and index also. Okay, so these are the basic things of documentation, document structure. There are standards also. The first one is called as process standards. In this case, what happens? You make the draft and you make the peer review. What mean by peer review? Peer means your colleagues. Okay, so suppose you have developed one product, you have developed one report on that documentation. Okay, and that report you give to the your friend or your colleague. So the peer, that colleague, will review that and tell the problems or whatever the inconsistencies are there, he will tell. Okay, so this is how it works. Okay, then if there is a need of revising, then it gets revised again. It is again checked, again revise, check, revise, check, up to when there is very less possibility of getting the errors. Okay, then there are product standard. The goal is to have all document created for a specific product attain a consistent structure and appearance. So whenever we buy a product, we get a brochure with that, right? So that is called as product standard or product document, user manual. Okay, so if you go through all the user documents or user manuals of a specific product, range of products, you should find that they are standard and not in monotonous, but standard and uniformly prepared. Okay, this is how the standard for product documentation is working. There are main four types: identification standard, structure standard, presentation standard, and update standards. Okay, now this is just now interchange standard. It deals with the creation of document in a format that allows others to effectively use. Suppose you are going to provide a PDF file, okay, and it is not convertible to another extension or another type of file, then it may cause problem. Like PDF may be good for end user who don't need to edit, but suppose end user wants to text editing, in that case you have to reconsider the format or interchangeable standards of the file type you are going to provide. This is usually not a problem with a single organization, but when sharing data between organization, it can occur. So when there is sharing between two or three or more number of organization, and the sharing of this documents is there, then in that case this is going to happen. Okay, there are other standards also. They are called as IEEE standard. Then are different writing styles are there. Okay, you just go through that and you will get to know. Online documentation is different from the documentation which is available in offline mode. So in online documentation, you have to provide some colorfulness to that, some additive security for that. If you don't want others to use that, so you can add security, or you can add watermark on that. Okay, so these are the online features of documentation. You can go and check this out. Okay. Then document preparation is entire creation and formatting. The definition is given. The entire process of creating and formatting a documentation for publication is called document preparation. Okay. Now, yes, this is the last part. Good overview of documentation. Though most documentation requirements are based on contact requirements, hard to cover things like that in a paper like this. Most of the content seem to be referring to user documentation. So finally, what is important, the user documentation that is going to be used by the customer is more important. If you are manufacturing a product and giving to or selling in to the customer, but the another type of documentation, which is process documentation, which is also very useful in some cases when you are not selling the product to the end customer, but you are just a business to business strategy firm. Okay, in that case you have to consider these both conditions. Okay, so this is how our experiments for this particular subject PDE are completed. So let me revise what I have covered today and what you are going to do. Okay, so basically two experiments have already conducted online, and you have been given the assignment for that, and most of you, few of you I think, submitted on the Google Classroom, and those who are remaining, they must submit this particular experiment 1 and 2 in next coming week. I will be sharing the Google Classroom link, the code, and also the time frame or the final date for submission of each and every assignment of experiment. Okay, so two experiments already completed. Then we have CNC 1 and CNC 2. CNC 1 and CNC 2 experiment is already covered in some lectures. That lectures are being has been already uploaded on Google Classroom. So you have to go there. You have to see those lectures. You have to learn those lectures. You have to take time for that. Then you have to go to the PowerPoint presentation of that particular CNC area, and you will get the presentation. Write the presentation, whatever given in the presentation, on your papers, whatever the papers you have, and you have to complete it. So this is CNC 1 and CNC 2. So basically 4 experiments. Then fifth experiment, user interface design. It is already in the last previous sessions we were discussing about user interface design. So it is already completed in that section. You can go for user interface design lecture also, and in that you can find the benefit data needed for your learning. Okay, you go through the user interaction, user interface design videos and PowerPoint presentation, and write whatever there is given on the PowerPoint presentation as it is on the pages. Okay, so there will be not like questions, there will be no any numericals also. You just go you have to write the essay type section on the particular theme. So this is how user interaction is completed. And the remaining three experiments that we have already today we have discussed about, that is PCB designing, how the PCB designing is carried out. You can go through the slides also, and there are these lectures also. Just write down the process of PCB design, that will be your experiment. The specific product specification is there, and documentation. These are the total 8 experiment that we have completed. So if you have any questions or whatever you want to ask, you can just SMS me or give me a WhatsApp message, so I will reply to them. Okay, So the time for which you should submit these things, I will be providing shortly on the WhatsApp group. Till now, I will stop here, and we will meet in the next lecture on Monday.